You're listening to WGHC 98.3 FM.
Why you? But we are nothing friend from see the first time. Up to trust and send. Why you? Get anything you like. Long as you are right and me are right. Me know you mad, that's why I'm alive.
Your voice. Your music.
When I'm in a first, our dreams are short shots. Head race when I walk past. Me feel the eyes, me lick the eye. Me love the light, me dream the pipe.
Baby, pana, they say you like you all up. I get to all up. Baby, pana, anyway, that's cool. I can follow you to go. Baby,
you won't let go.
You're listening to WGHC 98.3 FM.
New level, new level. New level, new level. New level, new level. I them turn Tony in a rebel.
Your voice, your music, your station, WGHC 98.3 FM.
All right, thank you all for tuning in to WGHC 98.3 FM, your voice, your music, your station. My name is Jeff Badu, and I am a serial entrepreneur and a wealth multiplier. I'm the CEO and founder of Badu Enterprises, LLC, which is a multinational conglomerate in the financial industry. What we do is essentially we provide financial services, including tax preparation, financial coaching, credit counseling, and all the above. And really, today's segment is to talk about taxes. So we're actually going to focus on taxes today. The 2019 busy tax season just ended last Monday. So April 15th of 2019 was the end of the official 2019 tax season for the 2018 tax year. Now, of course, we still have a lot more work to do. We still have extensions to file, or clients who are in extension who need to file their taxes. And you can still file after April 15th. It's just that if you owe money, you may face a penalty if you did not file an extension. And then also if you owe money, the failure to pay penalty does not go away. Basically, that penalty applies unless you request what's known as an abatement, which is something we can certainly assist with. So today we'll be going over tax season, what happened, some pros and cons. We'll get really down and dirty about some of the things that really went on this tax season. A lot of people might have been confused. Oh, tax refunds were lower. Oh, I didn't get this. I didn't get that. We'll really dig deep into why that's possible or what happened. It's really simple, actually, very, very simple. It's just one key word, and it's called, or two keywords, W-4 withholdings, basically. That's all it comes down to. That's what 99% of the stuff you hear about tax refunds really comes down to, is just the withholdings and exemptions. Nothing too fancy, but it takes a lot to actually understand what that means. So before that, we'll get into our market report, as we usually do. This report is as of April 19th, 2019, so as of last Friday. So essentially what happened was that stocks moved very little during the holiday shortened week. So it was Easter this past weekend, which had a blast. You know, happy belated Easter to everyone. But the markets were closed in observance of Good Friday. The large caps of the Dow Jones inched up a little over 0.5%, while the S&P 500 dropped less than 0.1%. With light trading, the CBOE volatility index fell to an 8-month low last week. Favorable earnings reports helped push industrial shares higher, offset by dipping healthcare stocks. The yield on the 10-year treasuries stayed stagnant last week. Year to date, each of the benchmark indexes essentially have posted, very comfortable gains. Comfortably ahead, and we'll talk about investing later down this, later throughout the presentation. But the stock market is very hot right now, basically. So the benchmark indexes have comfortably pushed ahead of their 2018 closing values, led by the NASDAQ, which is mainly it's composed of technology stocks. So you have your you know, your Teslas, your Amazons, your basically all the big tech companies in the world composed, or NASDAQ composed of that. And then followed by the Russell 2000, S&P 500, the Dow, and also the global Dow. COMEX gold went up. I'm sorry, the price of crude oil went up $63.77 per barrel to $64 per barrel. And then the price of COMEX gold went down $12.93.70 to $12.77.90. Although gold is always, in my opinion, gold is always a pretty good investment to have, especially when you're looking to offset gains, losses, or hedge your bets a little bit. So far this year, and these are just staggering, just obliterating type numbers right here. The Dow Jones is up 13.86% so far year to date. NASDAQ is up 20.54%. So if you're in technology stocks, if you just put your money in a technology stock, an index fund or so, roughly you should be up by about 20%, which is huge. S&P 500 is up 15.88%. Russell 2000 up 16.11%, and the global Dow is up 13.08%. Federal funds rates have not changed this year, so interest rates have stayed flat at 2.25% to 2.5%. 10-year treasuries right now are down 12 basis points. So right now they're at about 2.56%, which are, you know, a little lower than what they closed at in 2018 at 2.68%, which is basically around inflation. So if you're just in treasuries, I mean, you're doing bare minimum at this point. So, you know, time and time again, the stock market is usually, you know, performing pretty well, especially over the past 9-10 years or so. Last year was the very first time we've had a down year since 2008, which is huge. You know, and last year, nobody really knew what happened. But basically, well, we actually, some of us know what happened. But essentially, the stock market, to me, it's a great investment. It's somewhere that I would almost bet that it's going to go up over the future. The stock market has done about 9% on average. So if you put your money somewhere today in the stock market or in an index fund, usually I would say starting out index funds are where you want to be. Because that way you're not picking individual stocks. You're at least diversifying your risk a little bit. But had you put your money in, let's say, an S&P 500 exchange-traded fund or something that's a stable exchange-traded fund, you always do your research. Some of these funds do go bankrupt. But let's say you took some money, put it in. 40 years later, you didn't do anything to the money. You would watch it grow probably about 9% per year. And if you compound that, that's actually way more than 9%. So that's the power of compound interest, which ties into our segment really nicely of tax season. So what happened during tax season? What were some of the numbers like? What are some things that we can do to improve our lives as far as taxes? So this is also a free tax planning seminar or tax planning segment. And if you do have any questions, please feel free to call into the studio, 773-942-7167. Once again, 773-942-7167. You can also ask your question on Facebook Live. We are live streaming on Facebook. Find me at Jeff Badu on Facebook, and you'll be able to catch this live presentation too. So what happened during tax season? I mean, the 2019 tax season, in my opinion, was the most interesting tax season that I have ever been a part of. Here are some reasons why. For one, a lot of accountants retired, which is great news for people like myself, a young, aspiring CPA/accounting/tax firm. It was great news. I mean, it was awesome. We had a lot of business. I mean, we had way more business. Our firm actually closed the tax season. On the books, we currently have about 1,500 clients. And our target this year is about 2,000. Next year, our target is about 5,000. So our firm grew. We ended off tax season last year with about 600 clients. And we closed off the year at 750. So massive growth in the company. We have about 20 people that are directly in the company. Very fast growing. So the company's growing, and we're expected to have about 50 people total next year. So with that being said, you know, tax season was very interesting this year. Now, I'll share a personal story. I actually did not stay up past midnight at any point during the tax season. I did not work past midnight at any point during tax season. And that's just because I have a very strict discipline when it comes to working, when it comes to work-life balance, when it comes to getting enough sleep. It's very important for me to get enough sleep, to be well-rested. Body felt 100 times better. So if you're an entrepreneur, you're an individual, please make sure you're taking care of your health. It's very important that you take care of your health. You know, I was in the gym 3 times a week. Didn't really do that last year. This year, I felt 100 times better than I did last year. So that's just some advice. This is not a health seminar or anything like that. But as a business owner, one of the most important business principles is how to stay in shape and make sure that you're keeping afloat with your health, because you need that in order to succeed in business. You cannot be a successful business owner without good health. You can delegate as much as possible, but your business will still need you at some point. So that's just a little spiel. But overall, the tax season, we ended off pretty well. We had a lot of clients come through. Lot of changes this year, lots and lots of changes. We had the big tax reform that was passed at the end of 2017, which was effective 2018 tax year. So very important to note that the 2018 tax year is what we went through this past tax season. So all the new laws and everything that went into effect, they are actually effective as of January 1st, 2018. Just to recap, we already went through a segment on this, so I won't get too deep. But some things that happened was a standard deduction was doubled for all, basically everyone. Single, it's about $12,000 now. Itemized deductions were limited. So if you have a home office or if you have unreimbursed job expenses, those were eliminated completely. You know, they took away the ability to deduct HELOCs or home equity lines of credit, at least if you're using it for personal purposes. They limited the amount of state and local property and income taxes to $10,000 per family, which is huge. That's what affected a lot of people. And other things, they doubled the child tax credit. They pushed up the thresholds that you can hit for the child tax credit. They did a lot of great things, you know, especially for business owners, the biggest winners of tax reform. Now, if you looked at the history of the tax code, if you looked at the entire history of the tax code, you'll come to find out that the tax code was really meant for two types of people and two types of people only. The two types of people that save money on taxes, like tremendously, or who rarely pay any taxes. One, you have business owners, big business owners. Amazon, for example, did not pay a single penny in federal income taxes in 2018. So a big business like Amazon gets a lot of tax breaks. Is it fair? Of course it is, because they're creating jobs for people. They're building, you know, they're building technology. They're doing a lot of things. I mean, think about how convenient Amazon has made your life. You know, so for somebody to say that's not fair, clearly there's something that you need to either study upon or you need to consult with a tax professional. And you'll come to find out that it is actually fair, because all they're doing is they're using the tax code to their advantage, just like you can. The tax code does not discriminate. It does not say, hey, whether you're, you know, African American, whether you're Caucasian, you can use this code or that code. Whether you're, you know, of course, there's different classes, there's different types. If you're a business owner versus a W-2, of course, you have different rules. But that's not really discriminating. That's just creating laws that or rules that are meant specifically for your situation. So the code itself does not discriminate, but certain scenarios are different than others. So with that being said, if you're a big business owner, you're a huge winner in tax reform. So companies like Amazon, they cut their tax rate down to 21% down from 35%, which Amazon somehow made that 0%. And then second group of people, real estate investors, big time winners in tax reform and big time winners when it comes to taxes in general. The government wants people to create housing. They don't like renters. They don't like it when people rent, because it's not really increasing the economy in any way, shape, or form. It is providing housing. It's allowing people a place to live, not be homeless, and in order to, you know, go out and get jobs and pay taxes. But as far as true economic benefit for the government, a renter doesn't provide any sort of benefits. And that's why there's no tax deductions for renters, usually, unless you're a business owner. So if you're a real estate investor, someone who owns real estate, you're a huge winner. Now, a lot of people were saying, oh, my tax refund is small, this and that, it changed this, I owe this. Oh, I owe this year, why didn't I owe last year? Well, it all comes down to one thing. It's called withholdings, W-4 exemptions. Very simple. Basically, and I've noticed this is on both parties, the employers and the employees. A lot of employers messed up. They either forgot to adjust the withholdings, not necessarily so you choose the withholdings as far as the number of exemptions. So you tell your employer, hey, I want one exemption, zero exemption. The higher the number, the less money they take out of your paychecks. The lower the number, the more money they take out of your paychecks. Meaning that, so the higher the number, the lower the tax refund. The lower the number, the higher the tax refund. It's very simple. You know, very, very simple stuff. And if you need a reference to this, please go on my website, jeffbadu.com. I have an article known as, Tax Season Chronicles, Why Your Tax Refund is Your Own Money. A lot of people think that a refund is some magical money that pops up in their bank account. Little did a lot of people know, a tax refund is just money you've overpaid to the government, unless you've received the Earned Income Tax Credit, the Child Tax Credit, or the American Opportunity Credit. Those are the only three credits that are not your money, basically. So a lot of employers did not, even though people, let's say you write zero exemptions, your employer probably either the IRS did not adjust in time. Something happened where a lot of withholdings were short felt. So that's why a lot of people were seeing lower tax refunds. It's because the W-4 withholdings did not align with what was supposed to happen, mainly because the IRS had a huge delay in releasing the new W-4 forms for the employers. So I would say the blame is on all parties. It's on those who forgot to adjust their W-4 down from, you know, let's say they were at one, forgot to adjust it down to zero. That's one. Two, you know, the blame is on the IRS because they were delayed. And the blame is really on Congress because Congress delayed the IRS because Congress released a law basically during Thanksgiving weekend. Who's really working Thanksgiving weekend, Christmas, everybody's on vacation. It's holiday time. I mean, who's really thinking about taxes at that point? Unfortunately for me, I had to read all 1,000 pages of the new tax reform. And we've become very well-versed in the new tax reform, too. That's one thing that all these accountants that are retiring because of the fact that they just can't keep up, they're getting too old, too sick. We took that as an advantage upon ourselves to take advantage of that in order to really, really get to know the law and then be able to apply it to our clients. So overall, though, the reason why people are seeing lower tax refunds is because their W-4 withholdings were not adjusted. It's very, very simple. You know, it's not rocket science. It's not, you know, it's not math, simply the way that it turned out. But with that being said, now let's talk about, that's just a recap. Tax refunds were lower overall during tax season. It's a well-known fact. It affected my clients. It affected a lot of people. But what can we do in order to, you know, position ourselves better? Now, luckily, the IRS has adjusted, or employers have adjusted the W-4 now. So that's the good news. If you owed and you weren't expecting to owe, you're probably not going to owe this time around. That's not guaranteed, of course. There could be other things that you're doing. But I would say, technically, exemptions are no longer allowed. So if you really want to be safe, you just put down zero exemptions or zero. And you'll be fairly, you know, hopefully safe, assuming these employers are actually paying attention and they're doing the right thing. I can't speak for every employer. You know, I don't know what these employers do. But according to what I know, they're supposed to be adjusted. So if you're at zero, there's no reason, unless you have an escalated income. I mean, you're just jumping. You're doing really well in life. There's really no reason why you should owe if you had zero exemptions. So that's one thing you could do. You know, tax planning. You always got to plan your taxes out. Just like you plan your finances, or you're supposed to plan your finances. You know, same thing with your taxes. Don't forget to adjust your tax strategies and all that stuff. So very important that you make sure that you adjust your tax strategy. Talk to an advisor. We offer tax planning, for example. We meet with our clients 4 times a year that are on our tax planning service. And then if they have any questions throughout the year, they can always ask us for that too. So tax planning is very important. And that's a strategic set of meetings to basically reduce your tax burden. Remember, your duty as a citizen is to pay your fair share. Nobody said you have to overpay your fair share. You just have to pay your fair share, whatever that number turns out to be. So those are two things you can do. Make sure your W-4 is adjusted if you're an employee. And then also just do some tax planning. That's really all it is. So those are my two recommendations right there. Now let's go into a quick segment on, I know we started late, my apologies for that, but the last show kind of ended a little late. So we'll sort of brush through this. I want to go into a segment on how do you make the most out of your tax refunds if you were, I wouldn't say the word fortunate, because in my opinion, if you're receiving a tax refund, especially one that's big, you're doing something wrong throughout the year. Now, if it's, you know, a few hundred dollars, that's fine. If it's, I would say anything less than $1,000 in a refund, you've done some pretty good planning throughout the year, at least from a withholding standpoint. Not necessarily strategy. I can't talk on that because strategy is what truly determines your tax liability. But how do you make the most out of your tax refund if you received one? Let's just go into a segment on that really quick. So although your tax refund, and I hope everybody understands this, that if you receive a tax refund and you did not receive the Earned Income Tax Credit, the American Opportunity Tax Credit, or the Child Tax Credit, the refund you're receiving is your own money that the government is giving back to you because you overpaid it throughout the year. They're not going to pay you a penny in interest on it. They're simply going to give you the money. And then I feel even bad for the people that wait to the last minute, because time value of money is really working against you, because now you're allowing the IRS to eat off of you, basically. They're collecting interest on your behalf and not even paying for, you know, to you. So the longer you wait, the more they're making off of your money. Time is money. Literally, there's a time value of money. A dollar in your hands today is worth way more than a dollar in your hands tomorrow, because it earns interest over time. Interest is earned daily. Interest is compounded daily. So it's very important that you understand that a tax refund is your own money. It's not magical money that just popped up that the IRS is magically coming up with. But there are many ways. Let's say you're one of the unfortunate or one of the folks that might have overpaid throughout the year. There are many ways to maximize its utility. So always remember, though, that not receiving a tax refund is the most ideal scenario. If, like, the best scenario you can have in life when it comes to taxes, if you had a zero refund, and I mean, like, zeroed out, no money owed, no tax refund, just zero. That's a clean, ideal, perfect tax scenario right there. Literally, it means you didn't owe any money. And you don't receive any money. It means you fully maximize the tax value, the time value of money when it comes to the taxes. And you did not underpay the government. Now, some people might say, well, you know what? Let's take it a step further. Even if you owed money, you can earn interest on that money. Inflation is about 2-3%. And the interest rate, the IRS interest rate is about, let's say, 4-6%. Let's say you can earn that. The average, the stock market does on average 9% a year. So let's say you're under, let's just say you were under by 1,000. Now you do get penalized if you're over 1,000. If you owe them over $1,000, they can penalize you. But let's say you were just at $999. To me, if you're truly a strategist, that is the perfect tax scenario right there. When you owe the IRS $999. And you might say, wow, I mean, that, like what, you know, what's going on? But basically, at $999, you're not penalized. For when, you know, not making estimated tax payments on time and all that stuff. And you're taking that money, but you have to be savvy, though. This is not for your average person who doesn't know how to invest, who doesn't know anything about money. This is for true strategists that know what to do with money. So the ideal scenario is to not receive a tax refund. Hopefully that's clear. Now, most people, unfortunately, spend their refunds unnecessarily. I mean, before the money even lands in your account, they already have plans for it. They've already put something on their credit card. Next thing you know, the refund gets snatched up because they didn't pay their student loan or something was delinquent. So it is very important that we do these things. You know, it's very, very important that we make sure that we take advantage of these refund scenarios and all that good stuff. So when it comes to a tax refund, and that's known as spending impulse, by the way, that's when you're just addicted to spending. You know, you're like, you're basically like a drug addict, but you're a spending addict, essentially. So a tax refund, what you can do when it comes to a tax refund is there's really four things or five things you could do. Very simple. You can spend it like most people do. You can save it. You can invest it, which is what I usually recommend. Use it to pay down some debt. It's also could be a good idea. Or if you're generous enough, you can donate it. Not the most ideal scenario, but at least you're giving back. And some tax refunds, I mean, I've seen a tax refund that was $50,000. $50,000 tax refund. I've seen it before. Some of my clients to this day. That's not an ideal scenario for sure because the time value of money just smoked you immediately. So some tax refunds are large enough to make a significant impact. Now, one thing you can do with the refund, of course, I'm not recommending this, but is you can spend it. As previously stated, most people spend their tax refunds unnecessarily. This can leave them without anything to show for, nothing to save, and a bad way to start off the new year. One thing you can do is if you're a spending addict or you're just a spendaholic, you just love spending money, you just can't stop. Is I would highly recommend that you put your tax refund into two separate accounts. One account for spending, the other account for saving, or somewhere where it's not even, can't even touch it. I would go as far as nowadays, you can put money into an IRA account and just literally wire the money. Because once in an IRA, for me, when I see money in my retirement, it's money I don't think about touching. So I would say split it into two, put half in your spending bucket. If you're a spending addict, you just can't get rid of your habit. You know, you can spend half of it. That it's not ideal, but it's fine. Spend half, but have the other half go into this investment or saving account. And I would recommend a Roth IRA account. Very nice way to kick off the year, especially if you don't have one already. And remember, the IRS will allow you to split your refund into multiple bank accounts or multiple investment accounts and things like that. So very important. If you're a spendaholic, you love to spend money, try to incorporate this method where it's going into two separate accounts, a spending account, and then you have your saving or investment account or retirement account. So that's one thing you could do. The next thing you could do is you could save it, which is not a bad idea. It's also not a super ideal unless you're looking to beef up your emergency fund. Now, as just stated, you can choose to beef up your emergency fund with your tax refund. And with this, please do not have the money going into a checking account. Have it going into a savings account directly. I mean, like certain accounts you don't even think exist. I had a client who texted me today, "Hey, where's my tax refund?" "Oh, by the way, we put it into your savings account." She's like, "Oh, I didn't even notice." I mean, that's just the power when it comes to money. How mindset, how psychology can really change you is that just by putting it into a different type of account, you don't even know that money exists. Now you have this nice sum of money that's sitting there, and it can be used as an emergency fund. And in general, investment advice or general investment philosophy, this is not investment advice. This is general investment philosophy. You should have at least 3 to 6 months worth of your necessary expenses saved up at all times. Does it have to be in a pure savings account? Some of it does. The other can be in very safe investment accounts. And I would say, I recently advised a client on this, hey, they have Robinhood savings accounts now that pay you up to 3% interest. So take advantage of that. Your money is protected up to $250,000 FDIC. So if the Robinhood went bankrupt, you still have up to $250,000 protected of that money. So you literally don't lose. Remember, inflation is about 2-3% right now. If your money is not doing more than that, or at or more than that, then you're in trouble. So with the IRS, they allow you to put the money directly in the savings account. And you can also beef up your retirement savings. The first place, in my opinion, the first place your savings should go, or the first place your money should go, in my opinion, is a Roth IRA account. Like, that's a no-brainer. If you qualify, and technically everybody in the world qualifies for a Roth IRA, if you don't directly qualify, there's a thing called a backdoor Roth IRA. So even people like Bill Gates, for example, could qualify for a Roth IRA. So beef it up first. Beef that up first. Remember, you can pull money from a Roth IRA directly at any time, and you don't have to invest it. The point of a retirement account is to invest it, but you don't have to invest it. So the nice thing with this is a Roth IRA is protected from bankruptcy, from predators. And then it's easily accessible. You can take the money out whenever. Now, do I recommend this? No. To this day, I haven't touched a single penny in my retirement accounts as far as distributions or withdrawals. So it's very important that you just divert that money directly into your Roth IRA. I would choose that even before I put money in the savings account. Third thing you can do is invest it. You know, this is what I recommend. And this goes into, this can also fall into the retirement bucket too, by the way. But you can invest it in a profitable investment vehicle. Of course, you have to know what you're doing. Don't just, you know, close your eyes and put your money into something. That's not what we do here. We make sensible, smart business decisions, smart investment decisions. We're not just talking, hey, take your money and put it into Bitcoin without knowing what Bitcoin even is. We're talking, you do your research. You don't get bogged down on the research, but you do your research and you ultimately make smart investment decisions. You can buy stocks, bonds, real estate, exchange-traded funds. Or invest in yourself. Very important. Invest in yourself. Invest in your education. Take a class on investments. Read a book, Rich Dad, Poor Dad, Cashflow Quadrant, Real Estate Millionaire. I mean, there's so many investments out there. So when it comes to investing, it doesn't just have to be the stocks, the bonds. Sometimes you just have to invest in yourself. This year, I've invested a lot of money into myself as far as coaching, as far as my leisure. So I'm investing in my vacations / business trips because I found that when I travel, my mind is in a much different, is in a much better place. So I'm investing in myself, and I'm also going to be getting work done. Now, I'm not saying, please don't get me wrong, I'm not saying take this money and splurge it on vacation. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about truly investing in yourself and something that's going to pay off for you in the future. You know, something that's going to help you and benefit you. So, of course, a seminar, stocks, bonds, these are all things you can do. And then also what you can do is you can pay off some high interest rate credit card debt or some debt in general. Should you pay off a 0% interest rate debt? Absolutely not. That's a waste of money. Absolute waste of money. Why would you pay off a 0% interest rate debt when inflation is even 2-3%? You're literally losing money by paying off that debt. But if you have a credit card at 20%, 25%, 30%, you've got to get rid of that. I would even put that before, or at least put it as important as saving some of that money too. So if you have great big credit card debt, and if you're looking to just, you're just dying to invest or save, put half or so in your saving, and put half towards the credit card. I like the whole half strategy because that way you feel that each thing is getting equal attention. And that way you feel that it's fair. You know, nothing is getting more attention than the other. So pay off that high interest rate credit card debt. I mean, it can kill you really financially. And remember, don't pay off a 0% interest rate loan or interest-free loan. One of the worst ways to waste money in life. Unless you got it like that, of course. And even if you do, why not make some more money? You know, even Warren Buffett, to this day, they think the same way. They invest the money. They don't just let it sit. If they can get a 0% interest rate loan, best believe they're taking advantage of that in full. Last but not least, you can donate it. So if you're generous enough, You can donate the money. Most people don't do this, but, you know, donating is not a bad thing, and it can lead to some tax advantages and all that good stuff. So, you can be generous enough to donate the money, too. And I believe we have a question on the live, or we have a comment here from Loredana. Thank you for tuning in. So she said, save than spend, very smart advice. It's very true. Just because, and that's the whole concept, pay yourself first before you pay a bill or before you go out and buy that thing that you don't need. Save some of that money, invest it, do something with it, pay yourself first. Read Rich Dad, Poor Dad, very, very good book. Also great book, The Automatic Millionaire. I just read this book recently and it changed my life again. My life has now been changed again after reading this book, you know. And why I say that is because I'm investing a lot more money now on a daily basis. My minimum investment per day personally is $150 per day. That's the minimum. Next year, it's $300 minimum per day. And that's just, you know, that's just like small investments. That's not including the big time real estate funds that we have, the car rental business, the, you know, the tax appeals. That's not including anything. That's just me literally taking money, play money, and just putting it in somewhere. That, and we use Acorns, by the way. So Acorns is the platform we use for that. But Automatic Millionaire, I mean, just such important. Now, did I agree with 100% of everything? No. There's some things that were shared in there that I didn't really agree with, but say 95% of the book I pretty much agree with, and it's a very good book to read. It's called The Automatic Millionaire. So to conclude, to wrap up this presentation, once again, thank you all for tuning in. Use your tax refund wisely if you're getting one. Remember, the ideal scenario is to not receive a tax refund at all, because that means that you're hopefully taking advantage of the time value of money. Remember, as Albert Einstein said, compound interest is the most powerful force on the universe. And so it's very important that you get into the habit of that. And then to me, my advice is invest all or some of that money. And if you have high interest rate debt, then you got to pay off, at least pay off some of it, because it's going to eat you alive. It's very hard to make 20, 25% in the stock market. Very, very hard consistently. So compound interest can only not work for you. It can also work against you. And remember, you don't have to spend this money. It's not even extra money. It's your own money that they were supposed to give to you anyway. They're just not refunding it to you at a different point in time. And we have another comment here from Loredana. Great book to read is The Power of Zero by David McKnight. That's also a very good book. I advise all my clients to read it. And definitely thank you for that advice. I think it's very important advice. And thank you for tuning in once again. So our time is up. If you do have any questions, please feel free to reach out to me. My number is 773-679-7198. You can also visit my personal website, jeffbadu.com, jeffbadu.com. You can email me. You can find me on social media. You can find me anywhere. I love doing this, these presentations, these talks. I'll be back on next week. We'll be talking about some different things. I'll be bringing some more guests on the show. But thank you all for tuning in to WGHC 98.3 FM, your voice, your music, your station. My name is Jeff Badu, and I look forward to continuously delivering you all some content. Thank you.
You're listening to WGHC 98.3 FM.
But we are nothing friend from the sea the first time. One after dressing, send them a squire. Get anything you like, long as you are right.